inch, MICE, MCIOB, FHEA. My name is Engineer Patrick Obidoyin. I'm the Pro Tem Publicity Secretary of NSE Pro Tem Manchester Branch. A quick shout out to some distinguished members currently here. It might interest you to know that we have over 260 subscribers to this particular session. We want to give thanks to Engineer Mohammed Babagana and the NSC President and Engineer Dr. Alex Momo, who has kindly shared our program on the database. We also want to welcome Engineer Isaac Olorunfemi, a past president of NSE, who has also been very supportive of our branch. Engineer Olorunfemi, are you on, sir? Can you say a quick hello? Okay, he might be joining us. We also have Engineer Dr. Obuks, the chairman of the branch. Are you on, sir?
Yes, sir.
Okay, all right. Just checking. Okay, we also have members of the steering committee, which includes Engineer Camille Okedara, Engineer Dr. Mohammed Ngala, Engineer Dr. Akilu Yunus Katungo, and Engineer Dr. Irene Okade, which we refer to as the general in the branch. I'm also pleased to welcome here someone who is not an engineer, but very keen on today's topic, and someone whom I've known for very, very long, Reverend Father Chibuike Ojilere. He's a community activist, and he has worked around the world. Welcome on board, Father Ojilere. I'll quickly give a brief bio of the guest speaker for today. Dr. Oloke, are you with us, sir?
Yes, I am. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much, sir. Our guest speaker this evening is Engineer Dr. Oloke. He's a chartered civil engineer with extensive interest in sustainable construction research, knowledge transfer and consultancy. Prior to this time, he had worked internationally as a consultant and lecturer in civil and structural engineering. He joined the University of Wolverhampton in September 2000, so that's coming up to 20 years now. He has offered consultancy advice for various civil and structural engineering projects worth over £100 million. He facilitated training on various aspects of construction, health and safety, and electronic project management. As an offshoot of the work, several journal papers focused on enhancing the development of practitioners' knowledge of construction health and safety practice were published in the Journal of Education in Built Environment. He has also supervised a wide range of built environment PhDs with several publications accompanying the projects. He's a member of Institution of Civil Engineers Health and Safety Expert Panel. He also serves as a reviewer.
Engineer Patrick, please test your mic. People are not hearing you.
Oh.
I can hear him.
I can hear you.
All right. Okay. Thank you very much for confirming. Dr. Oloke is a member of the Institution of Civil Engineers Health and Safety Expert Panel. He also serves as a reviewer for intending registrants. These are chartered civil engineers. His work with ICE allowed him to be engaged as a chapter author and co-editor of the ICE Construction Health and Safety Manual, which was published in June 2010. The second edition has been published in 2015. His research interests continue to span a wide range of built environment and sustainability teams. And he has also been engaging with more industrial collaborators and institutions across Europe and the rest of the world. I will quickly give the floor to the chairman, Engineer Dr. Books, for his opening brief.
Thank you very much, Engineer Patrick. I join Patrick in warmly welcoming participants to today's session. But before I continue, I would just like to say that this event is being recorded and at the same time being streamed live. This is particularly because of GDPR issues. So if you don't want your face to be seen, please, you can close your video camera. Otherwise, the purpose of recording is just to ensure that we communicate the outcome of this meeting to other members who were not able to join us today. Moving forward, I would like to especially thank the University of Manchester for their continued support for this ProTem Manchester branch. At the same time, I would like to humbly thank the current president of the Nigerian Society of Engineers, Engineer Baba Ghana, who has been very supportive of all of our initiatives. Just to let everyone know that after the guest speakers talk, there will be opportunity for questions and answers. So I will encourage participants to post their questions in the chat box. And at the end of the presentation, we will allow members to ask the questions, or I will read the questions out to the guest speaker. At the end, we will have our general meeting. And after the general meeting, we have an open forum where members will discuss one of our projects that we are working on, which is the digital library project, which the current president has assigned to branch as a challenge to take on. So at this point, I will want to stop and welcome the guest speaker. So David Oloke, I will stop sharing my screen so that you can log in now.
Thank you very much. Let me just get my presentation up and then we can take it from there. Right. I hope everybody can see the screen now. Okay.
Yes, we can.
Yes, thank you. I don't know why there is an echo. I don't have two devices on. Okay, we're better now. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much, ProTem Chairman of the NSE Manchester branch. I'm really excited, and all the team that are working with our colleagues in Manchester, and everyone that's logged on today. I'm really thankful to the organizers for this opportunity. I don't take it for granted at all. I've had the privilege, I must say, I've had the opportunity by God's grace to present and do things like this on virtually every continent on the planet. But anytime I have anything to do with Nigeria, there is always a very different feel to it for me. I don't know how to describe it. So I really, really am very grateful. And I want to appreciate all my colleagues and senior colleagues. I believe some have logged on. It's very difficult to know who has logged on Zoom, but I'm very glad that I can see that Engineer Olorunfemi is on, a man I've known for many years, since the very late 90s.
Your roommate in Israel.
I know he was going to say that. we had the opportunity of traveling to Israel together and spent 6 weeks of our lives together in Israel with a group of about 32 people from about 17 countries, if I remember correctly. And I was still very much in Nigeria. Yes, yes. So we're very grateful. And I want to say thank you. I think I also spotted the engineer Olatunji. I don't know. I think I spotted him earlier on, who was, I believe, is the engineer Olatunji, who was my lecturer. I didn't see the face, but I a University of Ilorin in the 80s, one of the men and women who gave us the foundations that we have today. So I'm very grateful and thank you so much, colleagues. Some colleagues have texted. I'm really opportune to see you all. And I will just carry on with the presentation now. As you have heard the title, we're trying to look at researching. I'm trying to present here today something I've coined the integration of research and consultancy in alteration and refurbishment projects. And what I'm hoping I can achieve is to give you a bit of an introduction. Thank you so much, Engineer Patrick, for those very warm introductions and a brief bio of myself. That would really help me also to progress about the introduction to myself. I'll just put some more details just to give better context. I want to also talk about how I got into alteration and refurbishment projects generally, both from the research angle from the research angle and the consultancy aspect. And then what that concept is of integrating research and consultancy has been for me, and how it is growing. And also some of the research that we've done and what we're doing to date in terms of refurbishment and consultancy case studies that I think would help us to just see the challenges of these kind of projects and see what is very possible with them. And then I'll just talk a little bit about some of the countries that have had the opportunity of disseminating some of this work and participate in knowledge exchange programs. And then what we're planning to do, we've started, but what we're hoping where we're hoping to take this. And then obviously this being an NSE forum, I would like to just mention a few things from my own little experience on what I believe are potentials for us in Nigeria from the engineering perspective as well. And then I would conclude from there. I put these two pictures of mine because it kind of describes me in some. My engineering career has been a man of many hats, as some people would say. I wear these two hats simultaneously, and somehow I got privilege, or I don't know, divine arrangement. I didn't set out to be like that, but for about the 30 years that I've been in practice, I have been in both academics and practice of consultancy almost simultaneously, and in both countries, in Nigeria and here. My early career, I have a civil engineering background, civil and structural masters, and then did my doctorate here in the UK. So my early career really started off in Nigeria in the late 80s, 1989, when I finished. And the first sort of 10 years of my professional development, I was practicing fully in Nigeria. I did have opportunity, like I sort of touched on with Engineer Isaac just now, of doing a lot of training abroad in that process. So I had a kind of holistic international view to things very early in my career. And I think that sort of helped shape a bit of my perspective till date. I'm very, very pleased to say that I'm one of the first 10,000 registered engineers in Nigeria. And I put my numbers there, both with the NSC and the current. I must raise my hand up. I've not been too faithful in recent years in paying my dues, but it is a privilege because the NSC is a very prestigious, I believe it's one of the most prestigious engineering organizations in Africa. And it has the potential to do much more than it is actually doing because of the crop of engineers that that are on the books. And so it is with Corin. I became a member of the CIOB, which qualified me to be referred to as either a chartered builder or a chartered construction manager here in the UK in 2003, as soon as I finished my PhD. And then I became a chartered civil engineer, which is with the Institution of Civil Engineers in 2004. And I have been a resource person to the NSC, I will say, since my very, very pupil years. The first time I had the opportunity of doing something of training for the NSC was in 1992. I was just a graduate of about 3 years old then, but I was a lecturer at the Kaduna Polytechnic. And Engineer Fago Ibo was in Kaduna branch. He approached me one day and he said, young man, wouldn't you like to spend some time to come and teach our colleagues on engineering communication and technical report writing? I don't know how he thought I could do that. I just finished my master's as well from ABU Zaria. And I started, and that went on for about 2 years. So I was very active in the NSC branch in Kaduna doing that then. And I say that because, you know, it's like a lot of nostalgia thinking over 25, 27 years that, you know, it's having an opportunity to still talk to an NSC forum like this. Now, you know, from an international perspective and being able to even reach many more people across the world, it's a great honor. I have been I've been a resource person to Coren as well. I did a lot of training for them in around 2009 to 2012. I used to go to Nigeria quite a lot then, and I did some work with them. I have been a resource person to the ICE from 2005 till date. From time to time, I'm called into panels and groups and teams to look at issues, to write on issues, and so on and so forth. I've served in various panels of the ICE in time. In the last sort of 15 years. And so that's kind of like a very quick overview. I put these two things. I was trying to get a plaque, one of the plaques. I was given about 4 plaques when I was working with Coren. I was trying to get a picture of one of them. It didn't come out too well. That's the one on the left. And this certificate as well, I was given during the time London was to host the Olympics. Those of us who would remember, London held Olympics about 8 years ago, London 2012, and the infrastructure that was built, I was part of the committee that was looking, this was 2007, 8, 9, 10, part of the committee that was looking into aspects of safe delivery. So the construction health and safety, because I was serving on the Institution of Civil Engineers panel of expert panel of health and safety at that time. And one of the novelties I would remember was how we were able to structure the project into groups and looked at delivery from a point of view of using what is known as the CDM regulations in the United Kingdom, which helps us to manage health and safety, has a role at that time called the CDM coordinator, but now known as the principal designer. The CDM coordinator was a single person or single company role, but in that project, we were able to make room for CDMCs across the different packages. So those who are working on the aquatic had a CDM coordinator. Those who are working on the other parts of the main stadium had a CDM coordinator, and so on and so forth. And so it became very important that we were able to do that. And that helped quite a lot. So I just want to say, so we got that certificate then. I don't know who is, somebody's having access to the screen, but it's not me, definitely. So just check if you have access to the screen.
We'll try.
And you can, that's fine. Okay. So we're giving that certificate, and I really treasure that because it's one of the significant contributions we made to the Olympic delivery. By the way, that project was delivered. It is a legacy today. The whole of East London area was regenerated through that project. Now there's a lot of housing there. There's a lot of sports centers. I think West Ham Football Club bought the stadium and so on and so forth. So there are quite a few things that have been left as a legacy just as has been planned. So how did I get into these alteration and refurbishment projects? And for those of you that may need to know what these are, the picture behind me is an example. We're talking about projects that are not new builds, okay? They are not new builds. Most of us as engineers are very, very used to, especially civil engineers, we're very used to, and architects, we're very used to, you know, building from new, from scratch, and building from ground up, and which is fine, which is what we do. But I found in getting into work here in the UK, that about 70% of the work that we currently do in construction, at least in this country now, are refurbishment projects. They are projects that are working on very old buildings. UK, as one of the Western economies, as you know, is very, very rich in many old structures. Some structures are 1,000 years old, some are 300, some are 200, and they are still maintained. And so when there is a need to work on them, there is a degree of expertise that is needed. And some not so old, maybe 30 years. In this country, most buildings that are under 30 years are like new, are regarded as new buildings. But you know, we work on them, extend them, and make them more viable in terms of energy efficiency, because some of them are no longer efficient for energy consumption. And also where there is a need to adapt them for new uses and bring in new technologies into them. So when I came into the UK, I actually came in 2000, as it was said read in my bio, to start my PhD. And what I found is that within a couple of years, I was very privileged. I finished in record time. I think about 2002, I was ready to finish, and I was absorbed into faculty almost immediately. And I was given a task to train some. We had some funding from the European Social Fund, and I was given a task as with some other colleagues to train about 200 construction managers on things on electronic project management and construction health and safety. So when these people were coming in, we were, because they are very top managers and people who, you know, run companies and so on, we were training them, of course, on the theories, but we were relying a lot on them telling us some of the problems that were in industry. And that was my first sign of the fact that there were a lot of challenges that they were having managing these kind of projects, because these projects are very unique, as I will get to tell you in some of the case studies. And so this was where it all started for me. And I started to pick interest. So my first set of PhD supervision, which commenced immediately after my PhD, were people who worked on construction, health and safety. And I will show you some of the things they did, just the topics they did very shortly. Now, around about 2006, I took a risk, I would say. I would say it was a big risk, it was a big gamble to go on into work in industry. I wanted a full UK experience. My Nigeria experience was very good. I was using it to practice and I was okay. I was, you know, in my academic world and I was doing a bit of consultancy. But I found that unless I sat down with a consulting firm for some time, I might find that it would be difficult for me to compete at the highest level that I really wanted to operate here. So I left the university. I stood on as a visiting lecturer because I had my PhD students there. So I left the university and went into private consultancy with some firms. I worked with a couple of firms as a senior structural engineer and a principal engineer for about 3 years. And once I completed that, I came back to the university in 2009. And what I did from then was that I was now able to set up a consultancy practice, which if I needed to use to still be engaged with the consultant, because there was quite a lot of need for that kind of work to be done. And then I also have been running that alongside with the university work and then also supporting the university with consultancy work where feasible. So that's a bit of why I got into alteration and refurbishment. But I must say that I have also been involved in some very, very challenging new build projects. I'll just quickly talk about these three just as an example. The top two are in Coventry University. And they are my structural design. They look like ordinary buildings, but if I tell you the kind of challenges that go with these buildings in getting them up is very, very amazing. The first one, the HDTI project, was a project that was actually carried out on a brownfield site. That is a site that was used in the olden days for either mining activity or different kinds of industrial projects that have been done. So the ground is contaminated and it's also very weak soil. So there was almost a £1 million cleanup, £1 million sterling cost to clean up the site and put it well. But that was not the challenge. When that was done and we did the design, and I designed for pile foundations because we had the soil investigation said we needed to do piles for about 7 to 8 meters. On the average. So we designed piles, which is a normal thing you do for those kind of things. But the challenge of this project was the first day the contractors got to site, they were about to drill the first pile location and they hit refusal at 1.5 meters. When they rang, we said that when they rang the office to tell us, we said, that's not possible. How could you do that? That just couldn't happen because we looked at all the trial logs. 5 trial logs showed that there was no way we could found that this building on anything less than, you know, 7 meters. So we said, okay, go to the next pile point. We'll see, maybe that was just a one-off. We might need to blast or something to get it in and whatever, you know. They went to the next pile point. At 2 meters again, they hit refusal. And they went to the third point, and then they found that they could drill through. And then they went to the next place, they found that they could drill through, and they were going through like that. Some they found that they hit refusal, some they found that they could drill through. And to cut the long story short, what we found out was that the site was heavily underlain by an undulating layer of rock formation, which was missed completely by 5 trial pits that were by five boreholes that were drawn by the site investigators. And believe me, as at that point, in 20 years or so of practice, I'd never seen such a thing that, you know, you would always get the one borehole that gives you that indication that this is what you'll find. But for some strange reason, the 5 locations that they drilled the boreholes, none of them got the rock outcrops. All of them went in between. And anyway, so we had to, on motion, basically, on our feet, as we say, thinking on our feet, we had to redesign the foundations right with the contractors on site. So each point they had a rock outcrop that was close to the surface. We put a pad foundation, and then the other places, they sank the piles. And that's what this building sits on today. So every time I go to Coventry, I show my children, I tell them that if you know what this building showed me, it's not as funny as it looks, but we got through that. This other building is called the Simulation Center. It's one of the futuristic buildings that was put up about 10 years ago. Today, it helps the industry significantly. All virtual simulations, augmented reality, things that are very, very forward-thinking. The whole idea of the building is to be a lab whereby contractors, consultants come together and brainstorm on new and emerging technologies. So I took the worst perspective of the picture of the building, sadly, but there should be a more beautiful side, the other side with a curved edge and so many things that we put in. All steel frames and unique features of it, having the downpipe columns also serving as downpipes for drainage in the roof, and so on. They were supposed to be all singing and dancing, but funds limited them. We were supposed to have sustainable drainage. We had designed swales, so the water will be self-absorbing and all that around it. But, you know, all that was put aside when their budget was exceeded. So that's what it is today. The little building at the bottom is newer. That was finished just last year. It's a set of, again, very simple looking building, which is a set of 12 houses that are all together in a place called Northampton, Care in England. And what's unique about this? Again, ground conditions. This place was built on an old site that was bombed during the Second World War. That's another thing you find here in the country. We still find relics of bombs and things and bunkers that were built during the Second World War on some sites. And, you know, we have to find ways to build around it because you don't know the extent to which it exists and you cannot start, you know, digging up everything every time. So this site was one of those that had one of those basement bunkers. And the only way we could do was to make sure that we put it on piles as well and went around everyone. And so we made sure we bypassed the layer where those things were sitting. And then we had a system of ring beams that was put on top. And these are all new builds. And so I just put that in to say, I don't completely only get involved with refurbishment, but I find that there are unique challenges with refurbishment projects. Very unique, very, very unique. And I'm going to talk about them very quickly, as quickly as I can. The first thing is that there are design issues. There are design issues with refurbishment projects. There are too many variables. Design of any kind is faced with variables anyway, you know, loading variables, things that you have to determine, you know, exposure to wind and so many other things that you have to deal with, like I've been talking about ground conditions. So, but when you come to refurbishment projects, you are dealing with buildings that exist And also, you have to deal with them in terms of what work needs to be done. In this country, for example, at times we build upwards, that is, we increase the height of the building with a couple of floors. And at times we include basements, we build in new basements, which means we basically undermine an existing structure and put in a new living space beneath that structure. This is a very common practice now in London. As you know, the price of land in London is so high. So most premises, especially residential premises, are having some kind of modifications to make them larger and to grow up or come down. And so there are a lot of design issues involved. Also construction issues. We're talking about existing sites, very usually constrained. So you don't have the luxury of a big expanse of land where you can store materials and things. So you have to use things like just in time, where you drop beams and things that you need to use on site and put them in. And these are part of how we research, looking at processes that help us to deliver. So we study these things as part of our research activity. We have students and people who work on these things and study these processes and look at how best to improve them so that we actually test them on live projects. And this is one of the areas I'm going to talk about in terms of this integration I'm referring to. And then we have issues with existing structural integrity. How strong is a building built in 1920? How do you know? Who knows? You know, the drawings you may find are on some kind of paper that's faded away, and you are not even too sure whether that was accurate or not. So many times there is no record. You have to use a lot of subjective judgment. And so what we have been doing is that from project to project, we are documenting experience so that we can have a more robust database, because now everything, as we all know, is going digital. We have our very fancy software that generate frames for us, you know, and do all the calculations. When we are doing new builds, they are so beautiful to watch, and they do all your frame analysis and, you know, just give you your specs and you are gone. You can't do that in a refurbishment. You can't, because you have no idea what materials exist. You are trying to mix old with new, new with the old. You are trying to knock out some of the old and bring in new, and you want there to be an integration. It is a very different, very, very different ball game altogether. And then there are procurement issues. Not every engineer, not every contractor has competence in this kind of project. As a matter of fact, I know professionals in this country that would not do anything that is not new built. And it's not because they can't, it's just because they don't want to be involved with the risks and the so many things that go with it. And then that goes with project management issues as well. You need very good project managers, like I said, those that know how to plan projects very well to accommodate all these variables that are restricting the site work. And then you have aspects of occupation. At times, like the first case study I will show you was a project whereby people had to be inside while you were working on the basement. And again, you need to look at how intricate that is. So in terms of handover also, you hand over part of the project, you continue on other aspects, and so on and so forth. So all this leads to a lot of, coming from the health and safety management, for me, has tied it all together. Because when you talk about health and safety, people think about people falling off from high heights, or, you know, falling into excavation, or being hit by vehicles, which are very real things that happen, sadly. But proper health and safety management includes design considerations and construction considerations that are very, very important. So you have to have a proper designer's risk assessment, which means you have to have done the design very well, and you have to have used a proper method to assess the risks that are in the design. And then that is also taken onto site. And then the same thing is done with the construction work methods proposed. So health and safety tends to bring it all together. And that's one of the reasons why I have concentrated a lot in terms of what these challenges are. So when we talk about this integrated research and consultancy piece, I base it basically on the COPE cycle of what is called COPE cycle of reflective practice. Those of us who are in education would know about COPE. You can't be a professional educator and not know about COPE cycle of reflection. And typically we use it to train our students as how to move from concrete experience to reflect and develop new concepts, and then, you know, test them out and keep it going like that. I first learned about this when I was doing my PGCE, Postgraduate Certification in Education, in 2006. And it struck me very, very well that this is what we really need to do in a modified form in looking at refurbishment projects. So I adapted that to this basic concept, the same COBE cycle, but seeing how we say the concrete experience is our existing project, which is what we have and what we need to work on, what we want to improve. And then we need research. You see, what we do technically is just go from the project straight into consultancy in the typical fashion, and then we refurbish. So we typically eliminate research. Or at times, existing projects are researched upon, but there is no interaction with consultancy. And so there is existing project research, and then some kind of refurbishment just takes place. So there is a disjoint. But when you look at the cycle, it allows us to actually integrate everything if we can get the concept right. So we're talking about having an existing project, researching into some of the problems like the ones I've raised just now, and then testing them out through active consultancy, through active engagement with designers and those who would specify, because researchers don't specify what gets done on the site. It is done by consultants. So consultants need to work with the researchers based on what the researchers have found are the issues in terms of the sequencing of the works, in terms of making the buildability, in terms of materials handling, and so on and so forth. So all the research elements should feed into the consultancy practices as much as possible. And then the refurbished project can benefit from that linear progression of that collaboration. And then that refurbished project ultimately becomes an existing project, which again, after some time, maybe 20 years, 30 years, whatever, the same process can start. So this is the proposal, that the integrated component. Now, there has been a lot of talk about industry working with academia. It's not the first time. This has been said even, I'm sure, before I was born. This has been said ever since. So it's not a new thing. It's not that there is a new concept there about industry working with academia. But the key thing here is bringing it in the context of what we call co-creation, as opposed to collaboration. Co-creation means that we are actually physically, we are not just collaborating to do it. That is the word that we have used for up till, you know, about 10 years ago. The collaboration is good, but we need to co-create. We need to all be contributing to this refurbished project from both the research angle and the consultancy angle, not just to have research that we are doing just to test things and, you know, if it works for us, we leave it at that. And at times it's picked up by industry or not. If it doesn't make money for industry, they don't use it. This is what is happening typically. If it doesn't make money for industry, they don't use it. And then the consultants don't necessarily want to work with researchers because they don't see the value add, and so on and so forth. But when we use this approach of co-creation, what tends to happen is that we're having better outputs with the projects that we're doing, and we're able to. So very quickly, some of the research work that I've done, and some of my ex-PhD students are listed here, just some of them. I've had about very close to 20 now, I think about 17 of them, but some of them now just that have worked on these projects with me, right from 2006. Dr. Manasseh, he teaches now and lectures at Glasgow Caledonian in Scotland. Dr. Yu is a Chinese man, very, very lovely chap. He finished 2009, went back to China. Things were booming for them very well. So he got faculty position back in his country. Dr. Ipe, I believe he practices now in Canada, and he worked on cost-benefit analysis of accident prevention. And his work was to stimulate contractors to try and see the benefits of implementing good health and safety practices. And then one of our Nigerian colleagues as well, I think Dr. Ipe was the first Nigerian, then Bashir is also a Nigerian. Bashir is also still currently here in England. And he worked on looking at construction health and safety and lean construction practices. Between 2011 and 2000 and basically ongoing, I have been working a lot with different research associates and myself personally, working on different cases. I'm presenting work at the CIB Working Group 99, which is the Health and Safety Task Group. Washington 2011, Singapore 2012, Sweden 2014, Belfast 2015, Finland in 2016, Cape Town 2017, Cape Town, South Africa, and Hong Kong last year. So these works have continually been, I chose to go down the route of conferences very emphatically because it helped with the networking. And the CIB conferences I specifically chose because it was a very good, it was, CIB has a very good mix of academics and practitioners, as opposed to most others, with all due respect, most other conferences that tend to have emphasis on either, especially academics alone. So the CIB conference has really worked well for us in developing and looking at things. We had a small funded smart concept fund project recently, which we have just finished a proof of concept of looking at the smart city concepts for building refurbishment. So that was done. I have a colleague now who is working, he's an English guy, John Cooney. John might be listening to this presentation. I think he said he would try and join. John started his PhD last year, and John is a very, very brilliant chap. He's working on heritage, very, very daring, working on heritage, you know, properties from the 14th, 15th, 16th century. And because some of these properties are becoming very old and dilapidated, as you can imagine. So he's working on doing what is called the heritage BIM, which is a heritage building information modeling to look at how certain aspects of occupational safety can be considered in these refurbishment works. So those are direct research works that we're doing. And part of our frameworks and models that we have developed over time, I won't bore you about this. I'm trying to make this as light touched as possible because this is Friday night. Some of the information here is just to show how we have over time looked at with action research, how information flow between the client and the designers involved and the contractor can feed into a model that allows this co-creation as much as possible so that it doesn't just serve the purpose of fulfilling, say, the CDM regulations, which we use to manage health and safety on construction sites, but it also leads to an output that addresses all these issues, both from the stakeholder perspective and input from industry. The other model that we have found that has worked very well, this one was recently developed by an action research on one of our on one of our projects in London. And this was just to demystify the fact that in building, in refurbishment projects, you can't just move from brief to design to construction, which is very typical with many new builds. Brief to, to construction. But in this case, what we felt is that because you are dealing with many unknowns, the client must start with a brief. And this is what we're proposing. The client is the owner of the project. He knows what he wants to achieve, obviously. So they know what they want to achieve. So they start with the brief. And with that brief, there should be a consideration of these four things. What is the stability of the structure? What will be the safe work systems? What will be the plans that would work, and what will be a risk register in terms of how things can be built. Then we move to an initial, we check that, have a status of everything, come and do an initial assessment. This is another thing that needs a lot of skill. In this country, there's very active participation of building surveying. But when it comes to building surveying or structural appraisal of buildings, it needs a degree of expertise, which is you can't teach in classrooms, really. It takes experience because no two buildings in that category, in these categories, are the same ever. So you do an initial assessment. What is the building now? What kind of foundations was it built upon? And will it be able to accommodate this new proposal? And then the building fabric itself, where buildings have load-bearing members like walls and things that are used. Don't forget, back in Nigeria, I know we're very used to frame structures. We use frame structures a lot, especially reinforced concrete frames and now steel frames a lot. But say in countries like the UK, a lot of buildings are masonry, which means that they rely on load-bearing walls to transmit loads from the roof down to the foundation. So when you take out a wall, you can basically knock out the building, you know, not just by disproportionate collapse now, but by total collapse, because it is an essential element. You can imagine what it's like in a frame building when you take out certain columns, and you can imagine what it is like. So it's the same thing if you take out walls. And many times walls need to be removed. And you will see in some of the case studies here that walls need to be removed. And when they are removed, they can undermine the integrity of the structure. So we have to do that initial assessment, check everything in terms of stability, come back and do an initial design. This is where we propose that initial design should start after the assessment of the structure. And then we gain, after the design, we look at the impact on our four variables and then update them and come back and do an initial strip out. So we're trying to get a doctoral student to work on this as an algorithm so that it can be properly programmed and designers can use this and clients can also interact with this kind of tool to help them to know what they need to be checking when they're about to implement their structure. So that there's after strip out, we can move to construction and even phase the construction. So we have stage one. If necessary, we can go on to stage two, stage three, stage four, depending. But just for emphasis, we made it stage one and stage two in this flowchart. And we check everything and do a complementary design, which at stage five is better than, it's now an update of what we have done in stage three. Now we know more about the materials. We know more about the frame. We know more about ground conditions, so we can complement the design. And then we continue the construction into stage two right through the completion. So this is part of what research helps us to do by looking at these things from the academic point of view. So some case studies that we have done, I will just show you some pictures and talk around them. This is being recorded, I believe, so you know you might be able to pick up the points because there are not too much text on them. I did talk about an important building that we worked on, and I was involved, I was brought in to offer some advice on this as far back as 2011 it was. This is actually the Qatari Embassy in London. That's the building they use. Five stories. Again, you can see Victorian style architecture. And what was the proposal? To recreate a prayer room. Of course, this is Qatari Embassy, so they wanted to have their mosque in the building, but in the basement. And they had a storage space in the basement. So this is the whole building. Everything here is the whole building. And again, you can see typical London construction. The building is terraced, and so there are other buildings attached to it. So, you know, when you have this context, you can see that nothing is allowed to go wrong. This is a live street with everybody around and so many things. And this is an embassy where visas are issued. It's a consular services. So many things must happen. So they could not afford to close. And we were to work, the participants of the team were to work and in the basement. So you come in here, and this is one of the access to the basement there, and then the other side, when you go into the other side. So this was work to be done. Now, this is the plan of the basement, and every blue mark you see there are the walls that were taken out and replaced by box frames. Because these are load-bearing walls that are supporting load from the fifth floor, the roof, the fifth floor, right through. You know, you can imagine when the embassy is full, and there are many people there. So again, this is part of what I talk about, those design variables. In typical design, you allow for floor loading and you allow for materials, you allow for those kind of things and just, you know, make your estimate about the kind of loading. But where you have dynamic loading and you are not quite sure the number of people, it could be 50 people in a day, it could be, you know, 100 people coming in the next day, you have to allow for all those kind of things happening. And then services cannot be cut because this is winter time, heating must be on, and so on and so forth. So it was a very big challenge. So we had to study the building and look at ways of helping the contractor to develop a method statement. And I was involved particularly with aspects of the design in designing the box frames that was to hold up the structure when the buildings were knocked out, when the walls like these ones were knocked out, especially this very major one, and then these other ones here. So what we did is, we implemented a system of box frames. You can see how untidy it looks. These are all live cables, except some of the new ones that were being put in, because they could not be isolated at any point in time. The works had to go on throughout the period, and the work statement of the contractor included, you know, making sure that those live systems and live services were properly accounted for. Now, what you see here is a typical box frame, which means that this was a wall that was removed, and we've now put this steel beam to hold up the remaining wall and a column that goes in. And then we have another ground beam of column there, another ground beam of steel that allows us to support this wall. So that's the kind of thing. And this is another picture. This is what happened when we were finishing. And that is what it looked like at the end. And I guess they were happy to have their building and to have the prayer room and all the things that they needed in place so that because it did not affect their operations one day. So this is the kind of co-creation thing I'm talking about, that it allows us to, we used our expertise both from the engineering perspective and also research into working in buildings like this, looking at method statements and temporary works that can be used to hold up walls whilst these new structural members were being introduced. I did talk about competence. In this kind of projects, you have to really assess the contractor's competence because this is a very, very, it's a high risk project. Anything going wrong means, you know, hundreds of people could die at a time. It's terrible. You just don't want to imagine it. So it's what we have there, and that's there. We also converted an educational building into a multipurpose conference hall. And this is what was done. This was like an educational building in two floors. And what the client wanted here was to have all the walls and columns here removed so that they can have a free space here. Now, this was a building that had several columns and a floor, which was precast concrete. And this is what we eventually did. This was redesigned completely. All the columns in the center here and the walls, you can see, have been removed. And a new frame system was put in with the blue signs there. So all the blue marks there, again, represent the new steel work that needed to go in. And that was the model of the structural frame in 3D that was put in. And I've skipped a lot of things here because for this to go in, we had to do proper site investigations to check the foundations and to be able to design these frames properly. And then the method statement as well. These were very long beams on a very confined site. Some of the beams were about 20 meters long and they had to be brought in, craned in and hoisted into place, you know, at the same time. So a lot of planning had to go into that and a lot of studies complemented the recommended sequence that would allow a seamless supply right from the fabrication center to the site and straight to location. So some of the beams arrived on site just at the time they needed to go in. And all that had to be action timed and so on and so forth. So that's the frame. And this is when the strip out took place. You can see the old frame there with the precast concrete slab. And things like this had to be cleared out to create that space. And then these columns were replaced because they didn't have the capacity to take new long spanning beams, which is the picture you have, is this typical of the picture you have, I have behind, you have been seeing at my background. I think it's this particular one I actually used. And these are the new frames that have gone in and were allowed. So it cleared all the intermediate frames and walls and so on and so forth. And you can see the completed structure. And it is actually a very good feel when you go into these kind of buildings after you've been party to knowing what has happened. The downside of it is that you don't enjoy the atmosphere like everybody does because you are thinking of all the challenges you went through in the projects and in the things that had to go in to make it happen most of the time. But it's part of what we enjoy as engineers when we look back and see people use our facilities and the things that we've been able to do. The quick one again, a city center hotel. This one,
David, just if I can chip in, David, because yes. of time, just to remind you about time, okay? But I know the participants are enjoying it, so it was hard for me to budge in.
No problem.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you. I'll just quickly round up now. I know that I will have to be stopped because if you let me go on the refurbishment, we'll be here till tomorrow. Very quickly, city center hotel, and we wanted to put some new floors there. And you can see these areas that are shaded are the top parts and the different things that were. So this is the existing structure, the white structure. This roof space needed to be created as a new living space for the hotel. And this is an addition. So in this kind of case, we have to do foundation assessment to check the condition of the existing foundation, whether it can take the new load. Again, that is like a reverse engineering because this has already been built, as is already in place, has been there for years. So you have to do a lot of things to check whether it can still be capable and will not settle after the conversion before you can even get a permission to do the construction. So very quickly, that is what it looks like on the side. These are the things. So this area, I just put the picture of what it was. This is it. So this is just a picture of some of the steel frames that went in that roof space that I've shown there. I had many other pictures, but I just picked that one to see how this old profile of the roof was what it was. So we raised it with a new beam system there, like a mansard, and that's what it looked like at the end of the day, and we were able to create that. Again, there's no time to look at this one. This is a very, very interesting project, just finished last year. This is for a church, actually. They bought an old factory unit, very old factory unit that was disused for a long time, a lot of rail lines here and so on and so forth. They knocked down these two units, units one and two, and they wanted to maintain this and refurbish it to turn it into a hall so that all this area will be used for future development and currently as a car park. That's what it looked like when we knocked down units one and two. And you can imagine this mess left there, and we converted it ultimately. That's the BIM model that we're developing. We're still doing some project research work on this project to develop a BIM model for it. And we had to do some plate loading tests on the slab. I don't have time to go into the details of why we had to do that, but we had to check the integrity of the slab, whether we could, because we put a new mezzanine floor in. So we had to do this testing and check the results to be able to say that it can hold. And look at that, you know, seeing this being transformed into this should give you some joy. This is part of what refurbishment can do. You know, this is the beauty of it. And this is inside the building, the church facility. It's actually the Winners Chapel in Birmingham. And those of you that know the church, they have a taste, high taste for fancy buildings. And some dissemination outputs, just I've told you about some of these things that have taken place. You have heard about our manual, first published 2010 and 2015. Kieran is my colleague. We've worked together for many years. Kieran now currently heads the health and safety panel. He's an Irishman, Northern Ireland, actually, Northern Ireland he's from, and worked with him on this. This is my newest baby. It's just been published last month. And when this presentation is shared, you can click on these things and see links to the books. But there's an article here that I was asked to write for the ICE just last month as well, as a result of COVID-19 and how contractors can work better on these kind of projects. So you will see that article on this link. That's what we're proposing going forward, that everything will center around. We call it a BIM model, but really this is about digital technologies. And we will do everything around it: construction, facilities management, building performance, data capture. This is for refurbishment projects. And we are continuing to research about how these things will continue to feed in better into management through digital means. And all the knowledge we are acquiring on these projects, we are putting together so that we can use them to develop these systems very well. We've made a lot of these presentations. Abu Dhabi Police Force used to have a very strong engineering team. We've done some training for them over the years, some in China. Chongqing, China is the southeastern part of China that is very much into these kind of projects. We've had some presentations there. Obuks and I were in Malaysia 2 years ago, 3 years now, as part of the heritage project that was led by Eric Liu and his team at that time. Did some knowledge exchange in Barcelona, Spain as well on these kind of projects. And Nigeria, I was in Nigeria last year, July, and we were discussing with some stakeholders from various backgrounds, from federal ministries, consultants, other universities, on looking at reusing some of these materials as part of what we're doing for our contributions to sustainability. And we're still working together as a task group. We put that together just last year so that we can look at these things. So my final points are that there are potential opportunities in Nigeria to be looking at our older buildings. We can retrofit some of our failing structures where feasible rather than just knocking them down. We need to train stakeholders, give more awareness of what we can do. Then we as engineers particularly need to understand the unique aspects. Even in this country, we do a lot of training on those. on things on investigations, procurement, design, construction, project management, relevant to these kind of projects. And so I want to say it can be a very challenging aspect of practice, but we need to see that integrating research and consultancy will help us to do much better. And most countries will fare better in this regards as we develop capacity. Some of the other things I do very quickly, I manage a degree apprenticeships for our School of Architecture and Built Environment, which I can talk about if somebody asks more questions about what that entails. I am also a pastor of a charity, a church charity, but also we have a communities outfit. You can see the website there. We run projects with BBC. We have some summer programs for young people. We're trying to get into some programs for helping community kids develop digital technologies. And obviously, my practice company is a progressive concept. And if you go to the website, you'll see some of these projects that have been developed. Thank you so much for your time. And I thank you for stopping me, because if you did not stop me, I'll still be going on for another hour. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, David, for that fascinating insight into refurbishment. I think it's now time for questions. I have a question that has been posted, which I don't know if David can see it. Otherwise, I can read it out for David to respond. If you also would like to speak or ask your question directly, and just put your hands up and we will unmute you so you can speak. So David, the first question, just in case you haven't seen it, is asking, what are the roles of mechanical, especially electrical, and other professionals in building refurbishment?
Thank you for that question. It's a very, very significant question. Extensive, I will say, depending on the extent of refurbishment that needs to be done. Some projects actually are much more about the role of mechanical and electrical engineers, services engineers, as we call them, because if it has to do with energy efficiency, their roles are very significant. So it needs to do with BREEAM, what we call the BREEAM assessment here, which is an energy assessment model that we use to look at energy performance of buildings. So that kind of modeling needs to be done by architects in conjunction with services engineers. And also they help to advise on building fabric. So looking at solar gain and things like that for architectural perspective. If you leave architects, everything will be glassy and just fanciful. But I think services engineers can help substantially. And in all the projects I've described, there are services engineers that have contributed significantly to upgrading the capacity of the HVAC systems to make sure that they are serviceable for the new projects or the altered use. Yeah.
Thank you. I think I have Victor Akpatim's hand up. Just unmute yourself and speak, please.
Thank you very much for a very brilliant presentation. I have to acknowledge President of NSC, Engineer Baba Mohammed, Barakana Mohammed, and my past president, Oloke Femi. Thank you, and all the senior engineers and everybody present. Thank you very much. I left Manchester in 1979. And I was back for a master's degree, but in London, and then practiced for some time in Bristol and participated in some, I'm a services engineer, what we call MEP today. A few questions, let me just move straight. I've seen some design processes that you posted. What they put place side by side, the RIBA. Plan of work. I'm sure you are aware of that. What are the relationships? Number two, I'm sure you were just on structures, civil structures. Yes. Services will have a lot input there. Yes. Of course, you will be dealing with obsolescence for the kind of building, the age of building you talk about. You'll be talking about existing services that need to be very carefully handled. And you talk about upgrading, okay? And then we talk about today we talk about smart buildings and so on, so on, so on. So in a contemporary time, there's a lot, as you rightly acknowledge, a lot of inputs required from services engineers. And so thank you very much. But I know it's just civil structures. We've come to services a different world entirely. Then the river plan of work vis-a-vis the new thing. Now, before I just go for you to that, there has to be a two-way traffic, right? Feedback from practice and then from research.
Yeah.
See, because what we experience, we have different regions of the world. You know, I rose back to Nigeria because I wanted to be a practical engineer here. And I've been involved in some other building, in some buildings, including the British High Commission in Lagos, and some other buildings. I don't have the Mobile, Exxon Mobil building and the rest of them. Now, you see, the what you will experience in the field, yeah, you feedback to research and they look at it for improvement, right? Of methodology and of course materials and so on. And then the research now also feedback to the practicing engineers in the field. You have new methods, better methods for better results.
That's the truth.
And so they have to work together. There is no way the two can work in isolation.
No way.
But in Nigeria, that has not been much emphasized. And that is why when talk of innovative planning and whatever, we are just not just in the forefront, I'm afraid to say, but I think we are making effort. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for those contributions. And I think this is a great opportunity that we have as an association now talking about the NSC to continue to drive this, because just like Engineer Akpana said, there is no way, it is impossible. What the ICE, I will tell you from this, my experience of the Institution of Civil Engineers here, what the ICE have done successfully, and the professional bodies like IMECI and so on, is they've succeeded in bringing academia and consultants together very well. And they leverage, I must say, they leverage on the little things that people like us contribute, people like us who confidently, or let me say comfortably rather, sit in the two stools. They tend to, you know, work with us quite a lot. And, you know, it just helps because we see things. I sit in meetings, you know, within 24 hours, I could be talking to pure academics, professors and all that, talking all the academic jargon. And then the next 24 hours, I'm talking to builders and contractors on site who don't want to have anything to do because it's a different world. But when there is the opportunity of bringing them together through professional bodies like this, we should leverage it and make sure that committees are working together to be able to make these things happen, addressing topical issues like this.
Thank you very much. I think because of time, please, can we make the question very short so that we can take more participants? Can I call on Gambo Mohammed, please? Unmute yourself, Gambo Mohammed.
Hi, thank you very much for giving me the opportunity. Hi, David, this is Gambo.
Hi, Gambo, good to hear you.
Yeah, David, I have a quick question. You talked, and my question is, what is the cost implication when you're talking about large project infrastructure?
I want to speak, hello, I want to ask.
Oops. Sorry, you're breaking, Gambo, as well. You've gone muted now.
I think it's a technical problem. Can you hear me now?
Yes, I can hear you now, yes.
Yeah. David, my question has to do with costs, implication of refurbishing large-scale building and infrastructural projects. Have you done a research on that and you see it's viable to go on with these large-scale projects, or doing it again is better? Take, for example, the HS2 project. Some questions now, you know, refurbishing such a project, I think, would cost more than the budget of the project if care is not taken.
Yes.
In the future, I mean.
Very true, very true. I mean, refurbishment is not always feasible. At times, you just knock down and start. It's as simple as that. It's no rocket science. But in many cases, the cost viability is there. There's a case for it. and it improves. And if it is going to improve revenue, if it's a commercial property, if it will improve revenue, some of that investment will be recouped in next to no time. For example, if somebody was adding more units of flats, for example, to a building that already exists, it currently exists as three flats, but they've made it up to six, you automatically double the potential income earning, and then whatever has been the investment in a few years will be recouped. In a place like London, it's very, very quick turnaround. So it's those kind of things, but you are very right. It has to be, cost has to be considered as a very, very first thing to do to see whether it's feasible or not.
Thank you. Engineer Dr. Bernard, please.
Thank you very much. Good evening. I'm calling from MSC Kaduna in Nigeria here. Okay. I want to start by thanking the presenter for a paper we presented, but I would like him to shed more light in the aspect of soil investigations. You know, he mentioned in the course of the studies to carry out this refurbishment work, you have to study to see the nature of the foundation, to see whether it is safe before you can now go into your aspect of refurbishing. So I would like him to shed more light to know the methods that are adopted in some of these structures, because when you look at the stability of the structure, if you're not careful, in the course of your investigation, some of the activities may lead to affecting the building itself. Yes. So I would like him to shed light in that area of investigation. How do you do it to prevent collapse or failures? Thank you very much.
All right, sir. Thank you for that question. Very quickly, the first thing is, if the design information, don't forget these are existing buildings. So if the design information is available and there has been a soil investigation from the beginning, we can work with that. We just do the assessment from there, do the new load case for the modified structure and check whether the provided foundation will suffice. That's the first option. That saves the cost of a new set of investigation. Secondly, if there is an existing structure, at times all we do are trial pits to check the depth of the existing foundation and what they are. So it's just a trial pit, visual observation. If it's just a minor alteration that would not significantly more than 20% increase load on the existing building, then you know we can use that kind of assessment. But if we're going into a system that would require extensive load change of the structure, we will have to carry out proper borehole logs and do all the full-scale, investigations to check both the laboratory results for plasticity indexes and everything, indices and everything, so that we can actually know the kind of soil in the strata and check the condition, the adequacy. Like I talked on the last project, the third project I talked about, the site investigation showed that.
Sir, thank you, sir. Bye bye.
Okay. It showed that under 5 meters was not sufficient, but you know there was other conditions that we had to find out when we were on site. So it's those kind of different things that we need to do. Yeah.
Thank you very much. We'll just take two questions more, please, because of time. I have an elder who has put up his hand, but he has no name. I can only see number 4848. I don't know if he can identify himself.
Yeah, thank you, Books.
Thank you.
Thank you, Books. It's Agat Dukugri here. First of all, congratulations, Dave, for such a wonderful presentation.
I appreciate it. Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you.
There's a popular saying that those who can't hack it in practice, teach. In other words, if you can't do it, you teach others how to do it. And Dave does not belong to this category. This evening, we have all seen the evidence that he is such a huge success in not only practice and academia. And I'm really very proud of you. Now, my question is on your Coventry project.
Yes, sir.
The unforeseen subsoil conditions. Did the contractor make a claim for that?
Very good question. Actually, they did not. The reason they did not is because we saved them money.
They were
very fortunate to reduce about 50 piles to about 30 at the end of the day.
Ah, wonderful.
So they saw that there was no need to make a fuss of it at all. Otherwise, we would have had to value engineer the whole foundation cost, and they would have lost out if they were trying to make it. And then we responded. I think the key thing there was that we responded to them on site, so there was no delay. We responded to them. There was no need to delay anything because as they needed to progress, we were providing the solutions for the next trap pit and the next pile location.
Yeah, thank you very much, Dave.
All right.
Yeah, thanks for books. Yeah.
Oh, sorry, Prof. I did not recognize you. You're looking much younger.
That's good.
Keep saying so.
Just to, for gender balance, can I call on the engineer Tinye? I know she did not put her hands up, but just for gender balance, so that a lady can speak.
Is she hearing you?
Maybe. Hello. Yes, okay. I can hear you, sir.
Okay. Okay.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening, madam.
I'm talking from Enugu State.
Wow.
From the video, you can see I'm on transit, and I joined the meeting late. I joined the meeting like 15 minutes ago. I'm trying to apprehend what people are talking about.
Okay, that's fine. Thank you very much, madam. I think so I don't lose my license. Can I call on my mother branch from London? Engineer Sunday Footballer.
Hello, Engineer Books. Thank you very much. David, you've done a wonderful job. People always say that academics only teach theory. All they know about theory. You've shown today that it's not all about theory. You actually...
That's why I didn't show any equation at all.
That's right. I like that. You put all your theory into practice. And that's what we need for Nigeria. All these things we talk about, we need to start to actualize it. So thank you. Well done. Obooks, good job.
Thank you, Dr. Sunday.
Engineer Obooks, please.
Okay, go ahead, please. Then Patrick, just come in after this last question, please.
Good evening, everybody.
All right, thank you.
Yeah, I'm really grateful. I mean, to be part of this presentation, but let me just go straight to the point because of time. Please, Dr. David.
Yes, sir.
I would also speak from the, you have answered my previous question, but from safety point of view, you know, that's this I could not give it vividly. When they have to increase the number of conversion, it's about refurbishment. A particular accommodation was used for residential purpose. Then was later upgraded to school. So what I want to say here is that issue of lightning. You know, the risk assessment when it comes to lightning has to do with a lot of things, especially if you're having the number of people you are having in the house, it's one of the calculation, the building materials, etc. So what I want to say here is that like all those warehouse,
yes,
sir. They are being converted to maybe school, churches, do they take into cognizance the likely aspect of it? Understand? Yes. Is there any risk assessment related to the life of people?
Yes.
For this particular case, I do not remember vividly, happened in Germany. They didn't even show the architect, the engineer, the service engineer that participated, but the owner was sent to jail. Mm. Understand? So I don't know, for safety purpose, I think everybody that's involved in the how to put all those things because it may not come to the mind.
Yes.
Maybe,
yes.
Because service engineer, mechanical, electrical, yes. May not be into even the lightning, safety, arrest, all these things like that. And it's very key to
it
the
is
safety
very
of, to the safety of the people that you just a contribution, people that be
very true,
using
sir.
The facility.
Very true, sir. Very yeah. true. Every conversion, every refurbishment works. The success is about how best safety is considered. That is what makes it a successful project. So the designers, like I quickly brought up this chart we developed again. Designers, all designers, when we say designer here, we're talking M&E, all the structurals, every designer has to do their risk assessments and say, this is what the structure looks like now. Based on what you want to do, these are the risks that we find. And they put it into this construction health and safety information register. And they collate it. Now, after the contractor has built, we have what is called the residual risk register. When I worked with them at the project that I showed you in that, for this project in my background, they had a gallery and they did not want to refurbish it. They did not want to change it from the old structure. And I said, this was used as a school. So part of what we put in the register is that if you are going to use this as a sitting, you can't use it for a sitting more than what you would expect somebody to be like in an office. And that was agreed, signed up, because if anything should happen, because we didn't touch that part of the structure, even though it was a floor, it's a suspended floor, but it was not to be used as a gallery originally. So like you mentioned now, sir, that if it is to be converted to another use, if it is not going to be upgraded, strengthened to take the new use, then there has to be a risk register that is signed to by the client, that they are not going to use it for any other purpose. But you know, that cannot be guaranteed. But as designers, as engineers, we must make sure we have that in writing because of future, if there is any future issue with it. So you are very spot on, sir. It's very important to do those kind of assessments.
Thank you, sir.
And you know, Patrick, please, can you come in, please?
Okay, all right. Thank you very much, Dr. Oloke, for the captivating guest lecture, and everyone really enjoyed it. Before we do a formal vote of thanks to you, I just want to quickly recognize some distinguished guests within some distinguished engineers within our midst. We had earlier recognized engineer Isaac Olorunfemi, FNSE, the past president NSE, and a very strong supporter of our branch. You are most welcome, sir. Okay, I don't know if it's dropped off. We also have engineer Olorunntoba Mojirade, FNSE, a national ESCO leader. I believe she's probably dropped off, but you are recognized, madam. We also have engineer Judith Ishidi, FNSE, a national ESCO member. Are you on, madam? Okay, she's probably dropped off as well. We also have Dr. David Edwards, our immediate past guest speaker. You can't hide away from us, sir. Engineer Dr. David.
Professor David.
Thank you.
All right. I think I've heard thank you from him in the background. We also have Dr. Sunday Kukola, the NSE London branch chair. I know you've spoken earlier, but we still also need to recognize you. You're most welcome, sir.
Thank you very much.
We also have Dr. Sheo Adediran, the Protem Scotland branch here. You're most welcome, sir. Thank you for joining
thank
us.
Thank you, engineer.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
We also have engineer Alex Ifeguazi, FNSE. Thank you for joining us, sir.
Thank you very much. It's a nice lecture.
You're welcome, sir. Thank you, sir. I'm also very pleased to introduce one of my seniors as well, who happens to be a professor of electrical engineering from Ladoke Akintola University of Technology, Professor Gafar Adepoju. You're most welcome, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
You're welcome, sir. So I'm also pleased to introduce Reverend Chibuike Ojilere, a community leader in the Niger Delta. He was really very pleased as soon as I sent this round, mainly for our civil engineers on the group, but he picked a lot of interest in this topic. You're most welcome, my father. Okay, I would also like to recognize Dr. Alohan Omorege. We thank you for your steadfastness and continued support for the branch. You are most recognized, sir.
Thank you very much.
Okay, I would also like to recognize Engineer E.C. Obuks. Are you there, madam?
Yeah, thank you.
You're most welcome, madam. All right. We also recognize our distinguished members of the steering committee. Dr. Akilu, are you there, sir?
Yes, I am. Thank you very much.
You're most welcome, sir. I would also like to recognize Engineer Dr. Irene Okade, our general.
Hi, good evening, everyone.
You're most welcome, madam. We also have Engineer Camille Okedara. Are you there, sir?
Hi, good evening, everyone.
You're most welcome, sir. And Engineer Dr. Mohamed Ngala. Are you there, sir? Okay, thank you very much, everyone. We also recognize you all. Thank you for taking the time. It might interest Dr. Oloke to know that we had more than 280 registrants to this particular guest lecture. And also, at a particular point in time, we have over 120 participants. So your topic actually generated a lot of interest. Thank you very much, sir. I now hand over to Dr. Books to continue with the proceedings.
So I think go straight ahead and invite Irene to give the vote of thanks so we can go to the general meeting, please.
So, Dr. Irene, over to you, please.
Okay. Thank you very much, Engineer Dr. David Oloke, for this interesting presentation. Thank you for sharing your impressive achievements with us. It is interesting to hear about your global experiences and your contributions to Nigeria as well. So we've learned a lot, and I just want to join my voice with others to say thank you very much for your time, and thank you for sharing your projects with us. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I really appreciate the opportunity, and I wish the branch a big success in all her endeavors. I noticed very quickly before I go, Engineer Al-Hassan Aliyu and Engineer Felix Atume are very senior colleagues of mine. They were also in the presentation. I saw quite a few other people. I can mention all the names as well. I really appreciate that they were able to come, and thank you all for being here today. God bless you.
Thank you so much, David. I think we are going to move into the general meeting. Participants are welcome to join, but otherwise we are bringing the.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, check the president, sir.
Can I have a last word, sir?
Yeah, with all humility, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I must apologize. I was also involved in. And I'm a key mentoring program. It's also as large as this, where there were over 300 participants. At the point I had to speak at that meeting, so I took apology, but I let them realize how important this is to me. It's a great honor having David. When a book mentioned his name, I said, my brother and roommate in Tel Aviv. I'm not surprised. Every time we have met, starting from 1998 in Israel, the several trips in Nigeria, I knew he was going to do Nigeria proud. I'm quite delighted, quite happy for him.